Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to the Military Heritage Museum. My name is Justin Chumak, Lieutenant Colonel, U.S. Army retired, as you can tell. Retirement's been good to me. Today, where we're going to go over, in broad brushstrokes, is the start of the war in Afghanistan. Now, the war in Afghanistan can be an entire college course and is going to be discussed and analyzed long after we're all gone, just like the Vietnam War, to this day, is still being analyzed. The war in Afghanistan, you know, some like to say, began on September 11th, 2001. Really, it began before that, except we just didn't know it. We can look back at Al-Qaeda and their activities in the 1990s, the Soviet incursion to Afghanistan, so forth and so on. But it really didn't hit us until that terrible day in September 11th, 2001. What I'm going to discuss is that 20 years in between that led to this horrible day, the fall of Kabul on the 15th of August, 2021. For most people, they don't realize, after 9/11, we went to war globally, first at home. Operation Noble Eagle. How many of you ever heard of Noble Eagle? Noble Eagle is the joint defensive operation between with the US and Canada to protect the homeland. Every time after 9/11, you went to an airport and you saw National Guardsmen, or you went to a train station and you saw guardsmen. Every time an aircraft didn't identify itself flying into the United States, and F-15s or F-22s were scrambled. That was Noble Eagle. That continues to this day. But here, we're beginning, today was the first day of Operation Enduring Freedom. Many people associate it with the war in Afghanistan. It began, as I said, today, October 7th, 2001, and lasted officially until the end of December 2014. But the one thing to see is it was located worldwide. It was combat operations against terrorist organizations to train, assist, and advise foreign militaries to fight insurgencies in their home countries, to deny terrorists safe harbors and bases of operation around the world. With the Afghan War, after 2014, it transitioned into a separate operation. Realistically, what it was the NATO headquarters in Kabul stopped calling themselves ISAF, or Enduring Freedom, ripped off their patches and slapped on a new patch. Pretty much the same operation, but without the combat operations. And that was called Resolute Support, or for the United States, Freedom Sentinel. Freedom Sentinel was a US operation to destroy terrorist organizations operating in and around Afghanistan. With all that verbiage there, basically what it was with Freedom Sentinel and Resolute Support was to train, assist, and advise the Afghan military to help them develop their governance and their ability to lead their country, something we had been doing since 2002, 2003, with various levels of success. And in that time, negotiations were taking place, starting around 2009, unofficially, ending, of course, with the infamous Doha Accords of February of 2020, which was signed by the United States and the Taliban. And I'll get into those in a bit. As I said, Enduring Freedom was a worldwide operation. Many people think of, when they hear Enduring Freedom, oh, that's strictly Afghanistan. Afghanistan, or OF, or Operation Enduring Freedom Afghanistan, is only one part of the global war. You had the Horn of Africa in this area, the Philippines. Many people didn't realize we had special forces operating in the Philippines to fight Muslim insurgents. Trans-Sahara, Kyrgyzstan, the Caribbean and Central America. We had special forces advisors working with local governments to fight terrorist organizations that were trying to infiltrate or set up bases in Central and South America. And in Georgia. So the US global war on terrorism really was a global war, except for the media would only prefer to go to certain places. Biggest bang, if it bleeds, it leads. My adventures in Afghanistan, as I said, or if you read, I did three tours in Afghanistan. The first as a captain in 2004 and 5, I was an advisor at the Afghan company and garrison levels. I actually went with Afghan National Army soldiers on missions of theirs. And with the garrisons, trying to teach the Afghans how to run a military base. Throughout that time in Afghanistan, I advised nearly 25 Afghan officers to varying levels of the success. 2009 and 10, as a major, I commanded three Army counter-IED teams operating in southern Afghanistan, in Kandahar, Zabul, and Helmand province. During the beginning of the surge under President Obama of the US personnel, that brought us to over 100,000 US forces in Afghanistan. And then my final tour in 2012 and 13 was a brand new lieutenant colonel. First, I was assigned to the NATO headquarters in Afghanistan, ISAF, where I worked in the strategic plan section, working on border strategy for Afghanistan. Following 3 months there, I went to an all-Canadian police advisor team working at the Ministry of the Interior, their equivalent to the Justice Department, where I advised Afghan generals and leaders on anti-terrorism, sort of their FBI, that's what they called it, was their anti-terrorist force, which was no different than a FBI analytical team, as well as other organizations. In my three tours, this is the areas that I operated in. Kabul, all the way down to Ghazni. Also, on my first tour, operated in the western part of Afghanistan to include the seizing of Shindan Airfield, one of the largest air bases in Afghanistan, which later became the Afghan Air Force's training base. My second tour in Afghanistan, I was entirely in the south, from Lashkargah in Helmand province, down to Spinboldak, Kandahar, and various other areas, basically the birthplace of the Taliban. So I've seen quite a bit of the terrain and met many of the Afghan people. Afghanistan. Most of you look on the map and see, okay, it's Afghanistan. What do you know about Afghanistan, other than it's a backwards, rugged terrain? What has anybody heard about Afghanistan, as far as what kind of country it is? Yes?
Corruption and drug lords.
Okay. We'll get to that in a bit, okay? But as far as the terrain and what it's like over there?
Mountainous.
Landlocked. Okay, thanks to the British, when they created, you know, the Durant Line, landlocked it, you know, from the Arabian Sea and so forth. But as you see on this map over here, the Hindu Kush, you see all that white over there? Well, the scale over here, that's in meters. So we're talking about mountains that are over 20,000 feet high. Anything that used to come in from the north, our military aircraft that would come in from the north to get to Bagram, which was right about here, when they cleared the mountains, had to do what was called the Bagram Spiral, which was a sharp banking turn, corkscrew, down into the Bagram, which only had one runway. We had troops operating in various mountain regions all along this border at various altitudes. During my first tour, my advisor team with the Afghan Army did a mission on a mountain at 12,000 feet, just to give you a little idea. And no oxygen was provided. Down in the south, as you can see, relatively flat. This is called the Red Desert. Major infiltration routes. For most part, this border area has never really been controlled. When I worked in the border section, learned there was about 14 or so official border crossings in Afghanistan. I wouldn't want to guess how many unofficial ones there are. But flying over this Red Desert, you would see tractor trailers driving through the desert over here, kind of looking like a modern day interstate. They had breakdown lanes, passing lanes, but it was all just trucks just driving through the desert and not a single Afghan border guard around to stop them. The size of Afghanistan is quite interesting. Now, remember, at the height of the war, we had about 140,000 personnel on the ground. That's US and coalition. That's the size of Afghanistan, just under 252,000 square miles. Okay, well, that means nothing to most people. But let's start putting into some context. Everyone always compares it to Texas. Yes, it's slightly smaller than Texas. But then when you look at the other conflict in the global war on terrorism, Iraq is almost 100,000 square miles smaller than Afghanistan. Yet we had more troops in there. Now compare Afghanistan to Iraq. Iraq, relatively a second world nation with highways, an infrastructure, port system, major airports, good lines of communications, allowing for ships and personnel to flow freely into the country. Whereas with Afghanistan being landlocked, our good neighbors, the Pakistanis, at times, even when I was there on my second tour, would close the border to US and coalition forces. We couldn't transport anything that came by sea through Pakistan to support us. They had the borders closed to us, which led to a whole bunch of diplomatic and military issues where everything had to be flown in. We have this airlift capacity, but then it affects other things down the road for personnel. For those who fought in Vietnam, where we had 500,000 soldiers, that was the size of South Vietnam. So when you start talking about why couldn't we crush the insurgency in Afghanistan with 100,000 or 140,000 soldiers, we're talking about, okay, well, in Vietnam, we weren't that much successful. In a country that was 3 3/4 the time smaller than Afghanistan. Afghanistan is a vast, vast, rugged, isolated, difficult country to operate in. And you'll see in some of the photos I have. The entire area of Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War, South Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia, still combined don't total the number of Afghanistan. And put it in a local ability to think, that's the size of Florida. So if you can imagine 140,000 personnel, and again, not all are trigger pullers, if you will, not all infantrymen going on missions, not all special forces, not all helicopter pilots, a lot of support personnel. So when you break that down, maybe about 20, 30,000 are actually ground troops going out on missions to cover an area vastly larger than even the state of Florida. To fight an insurgency, the Taliban, that had free rein along the Pakistan border, and I'll get into the Pakistani relationship with Afghanistan. To support our troops, as I said, Iraq, you had relatively a second world country. You had highways and stuff like that. For us to move around in Afghanistan on a good day, there was a thing called the Ring Road. Ring Road extended from Kabul to Kandahar to Herat, Mazar-e Sharif, and came back down to Kabul, hence the Ring Road, with one road going from Kabul to Herat. Well, you think it's a highway, right? Highway 1, as it was called. That's Highway 1. This is in the south during my second tour. You can see the conditions of it This is after an IED blast on the highway. This was an area we used to call the compound of doom. On average, we'd have up to 30 IEDs a day at this one, from this one compound. And I'll get into the reason why we didn't destroy it later. And if I forget to, please remind me. This is outside of Bagram, heading towards Kabul. During my first tour, we rode around in Ford Rangers, diesel turbocharged Ford Rangers, standard shift, great vehicles. Afghan police checkpoint. You had to really feel sorry for the Afghan soldiers and the Afghan police. Basically, they were put in these checkpoints, squad size element, maybe seven men, AK-47, cell phone, a radio, and maybe they got fed, maybe they didn't. Maybe their leaders came and checked on them, maybe they didn't. And they were told, hey, police the area, make sure nothing bad happens. Okay. This is the ring road heading towards Jalalabad. This was taken by one of my former team leaders. You can see the conditions. So if you imagine going through the mountains like this with a convoy, you're susceptible to the, one, the conditions of the road, which as you can see is pretty horrendous, and two, ambush. And the Afghans were masters at ambushing. And I say the Afghans, there's a whole bunch, Afghans are made up of various sects and groups, but the whole notion is the Afghanis have been taught to ambush since before time began, and they're masters at it. Afghanistan broken into various provinces and districts, Kabul being the central capital. Afghanistan really didn't exist until the 1740s when it was unified as a land for the Pashtuns. In the 1800s and early 1900s, it was occupied by the British. They fought three separate wars there. Afghanistan didn't come into itself as its own independent nation until 1921, when the British finally pulled out after the First World War. And it experimented with democracy at the time, but then went the way of a monarchy. And the monarchy held until 1973. Following a coup by the communists in 1973, experimented in communism. And it was rather successful during the time of the monarchy, the liberalization in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. Women were going to school in the 1950s. They were able to go to college. Girls were experimenting with miniskirts in the 1960s and 70s. Okay, the whole notion, what we envision as Afghanistan today, really did not come about until the 1990s. After the Soviet war that ended in 1989, the warlords began to fight amongst themselves. Corruption spiraled. Kabul became more isolated. Finally, when the Kabul government fell, the civil war kicked off, and that is when the rise of the Taliban took place in the early to mid-1990s. What the notion of the Taliban was Pakistani-trained Mujahideen who had gone to schools in Pakistan were indoctrinated, and they went back to Afghanistan basically in a way to crush the corruption that was spiraling out of control. Warlords, like all warlords or gang leaders, wanted to get as much as they could from the Afghan people. This led to a lot of the infighting and led to the bloody civil war of 94 to 96, in which the Taliban finally took charge. When the Taliban took charge, they took charge of the entire country except for an area in this part of Afghanistan. That is where the Northern Alliance under Ahmed Massoud was able to escape to. Massoud, one of the greatest Mujahideen fighters of the Soviet-Afghan War, had also been the defense minister after the fall of the communist government. Excellent Tajik leader. Unfortunately, he was assassinated by Al-Qaeda as a gift to the Taliban on the 9th of September, 2001, kind of in the preparation to take out any opposition to what was about to happen. Now, as I said, who are the Afghans? The three main groups of the Afghans, obviously, are the Pashtuns. Pashtuns make up roughly 37 to 40% of the population, depending on what survey you look at. Followed by the Tajiks. Tajiks, relatively located up in the northern, northeastern part of Afghanistan, okay, are the second largest. Followed by the Hazara. Okay, another group more in the central part of Afghanistan, roughly 24%. Followed by other minority groups of various backgrounds. Afghanistan is predominantly Sunni Muslim, roughly 80 to 85% are Sunni, with the remainder being Shia. And there's other minority religions. After the establishment of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan in 2001, the new constitution that they adopted authorized freedom of religion for all religions. And there was actually Jews living in Afghanistan, small numbers, but they were still there. For the last 20 years, a term came out while we were fighting in Afghanistan called the ACM, Anti-Coalition Militia. It was basically whoever we were fighting. Because at times, we weren't sure who was the bad guy. Sometimes they would join forces. And to call them, oh, the terrorists or the Taliban was not exactly a correct terminology. Because unless you knew exactly it was the Taliban, okay, which part of the Taliban? The Taliban was made up of various sects, various groups, various organizations, sub-organizations under the banner of the Taliban. They also had a political wing. Those are the ones that would go on TV, would go to Doha, eat chocolate, wear nice suits, and sign and do the fundraising, while the soldiers of the Taliban, operating from their safe havens in Pakistan, would cross into Afghanistan and conduct their operations. As I said, the Taliban. Okay, Taliban basically trained and equipped by the Pakistanis during the Soviet-Afghan War and continued to have that relationship with the Pakistan government up until even including this day. An offshoot of them was the Haqqani Network, very famous for their operations and their organization. If you notice this writing on the flags, it's the Islamic prayer. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad was his prophet. You'll see that on all of their flags. Different way they wrote it, but it's on all of their flags. And the colors of the flags are very particular in Islam. The white of the Taliban flag means purity, purity in their beliefs. Black flag, hell, death, fighters, okay? That's why you'll see it on the Haqqani, the Al-Qaeda, and various other organizations, ISIS. The new guys on the block, relatively, came out in about 1988 when Osama bin Laden, with 15 of his fighters, organized and created what would become Al-Qaeda, or the base. Their goal was worldwide jihad, whereas the Taliban were mostly focused in and around Afghanistan and the Pakistan area for their emirate. Another group called the HIG, made up of former Mujahideen leaders. At times they worked with the Taliban, other times they didn't. They were mostly located south of Kabul, and you'll see on a map where their operations were. They fell out of favor with a lot of the jihadists because they actually signed a peace deal with the U.S. and Afghanistan back around 2015 or so. But the new ones on the block were ISIS. ISIS, of course, came in Iraq after we had pulled out in the vacuum of our leaving of Iraq. The Taliban, seeing the success that the ISIS caliphate had, sent many of their leaders or their generals to Iraq to learn about what made them successful. Well, unfortunately, a lot of the leaders that they sent to ISIS to learn how they were fighting ended up joining ISIS. ISIS and the Taliban do not get along. Originally, they tried to work together, but when ISIS moved into Afghanistan, it was basically, hey, you're coming into our backyard. And there was many battles between the Taliban and ISIS. okay, NATO, who do you support? There were times where ISIS basically said to NATO, can you get us out of here? We'll turn in our weapons, get us out of here. And there was instances of battles like that. But the other one was brought up, the other bad actors in Afghanistan that really led to its instability was the drug and criminal elements. Marijuana and the opium. I took that picture of the opium in Helmand Province during my second tour. Beautiful plant, but when you see fields of it all over, that pink flower all over the place, or marijuana plants everywhere, you know that is the cash crop. We tried to get the Afghans to switch over to wheat many a times. Okay, yeah, I'm just throwing out a number. I'm gonna get $50 an acre for my wheat, or I'm gonna get a couple $1,000 for my opium. Yeah, I'll grow wheat all right, okay? As well as other criminal organizations. Afghanistan, having been at war really since 1979 with the Soviets, you had generations now that were criminals. They were experts at assassination, murder. Life was meaningless. Money was everything. So you would have Afghans that would be hired guns. They didn't care who they were fighting for. Oh, you want me to kill this guy? No problem. Give me the cash. I'll go kill him. Kidnapping, extortion, slavery. That was a big thing in Afghanistan and a major cash producer. To see how bad some of these drug and criminal elements were, my second tour, one of the first IEDs my team went to exploit was an 800-pound IED that had detonated under an American vehicle. The only thing left of the American vehicle was the shell of the vehicle. The biggest human body part we found was the pelvis. And that was from a marijuana field grower protecting his crop. Well, with any other insurgent organization, because the State Department has never considered the Taliban a terrorist organization. They were always considered an insurgency. Well, like every other insurgency, there has to be supporters. I can go down a whole list and we could spend days talking about that, but just generally, these are who were supporting the Taliban and many of these actors. Of course, you had Iran. Iran, not really friends with the Taliban, but enemy, my enemy is my friend, allowed weapons and things of that to flow into Western Afghanistan. And then you had these guys, ISI, Inter-Service Intelligence, better known as the Pakistan Intelligence Organization, who to this day continue to back the Taliban. They armed, they equipped, they provided intelligence, training, safe havens for the Taliban to fight us and NATO. And just remember, Pakistan's an ally. But the other one that was supporting the Taliban and their war against the United States may not come as a shock to many people. The People's Republic of China. Many munitions that were coming in were brand new, were obviously from China. And some were not, obviously from China. We started doing analysis of some of the mines that we were finding. We were finding a lot of mines. Now, keep in mind, yes, the Soviets laid 5 million anti-personnel mines all over Afghanistan when they were there. All the mountains around Kabul were mined. We lost some of the Afghan soldiers we were advising in those mountains to landmines. But we're noticing a lot of smaller anti-personnel mines that look like legacy mines from the war. Well, come to find out, upon analyzing the mines, they were made in China, just as copies of Soviet anti-personnel mines. Areas of operation for the different insurgencies. This is from the Centers for Army Lessons Learned, talking about the Taliban operating in the south, as well as on the border area, but you have the Haqqani network and the HIG. Always trying to stay close to Pakistan, so if they had to get back, they had their safe havens in Pakistan. Also in the wintertime, All of these soldiers usually went back to Pakistan, where they knew they were protected. And they would leave stay behind forces to conduct some operations against us to let us know they hadn't totally left. Well, to help us fight this organization, we had a coalition of nearly 40 countries. This is from 2011, December of 2011, from NATO. It shows all the countries that were in this war helping us. Let you take a look at that for a few seconds. It's alphabetical. Some of us used to call it the NATO tryout session. You had some countries that were in Europe who were not part of NATO, who really wanted to get into the NATO, they would send small forces there. Like if you look, you'll see Ukraine with 23 personnel. My beginning of my last tour in Afghanistan, my boss, my colonel that I worked for, was a Ukrainian full bird colonel. He was an air defense colonel. His deputy was a Romanian lieutenant colonel. My first tour, when we went to seize an airfield, I flew in a Belgian C-130. So the coalition did send a lot of what they could. Okay, many times it was either transportation or intelligence personnel or communications or staff personnel, medical personnel. They didn't necessarily have to send fighting forces, but they sent what they could to help us. Afghanistan was kind of broken up into various sections, or as we called regional commands. Like in Vietnam, where you had the corps, I Corps, Second Corps, Third Corps. In Afghanistan, you had what was called regional commands. North, East, Capital, South, Southwest, which was created when I was there for my second tour, and West. Those were created around 2004, and they all were assigned to various Afghan National Army corps. The Afghan Army didn't have divisions. It had corps and then it had brigades, the way it was organized. And each one of these was assigned to a specific corps in the Afghan Army, in which the NATO forces were assigned to operate. Like the Canadians in about 2005 and 6 moved into Kandahar, okay? Up in the north, the Germans. Out in the west, you had the Spanish and Italians, and so forth and so on. The Turks stayed in Kabul because of being a Muslim country themselves. They were able to secure Kabul for us. And inside each one of these regional areas, we had what was called provincial reconstruction teams, which were part of the nation-building programs. These were military elements that brought medical care, analyzed what was happening in the villages, what was the needs of that area, and tried to improve those areas with farming, road construction, and so forth. They brought the money to a lot of these districts and provinces. Now, the Afghan war, as I said, you know, 20 years, it's going to be analyzed, you know, well past any of us being here. You know, it could be a college course in itself. But in a broad brushstroke, you could see the Afghan war broken down into four different phases. You know, the initial one in 2001 to 2005, you know, with the mission of defeating and destroying Al-Qaeda, destroying and removing the Taliban from the war, or from Afghanistan. Prior to us going into Afghanistan on the 7th of September, CIA Special Activities Divisions, SAD, that's the paramilitary, that's the covert side of the CIA, as well as MI6, British Secret Intelligence, were able to infiltrate Afghanistan in towards the end of September of that year with suitcases full of money. If you ever saw that movie 12 Strong, where you see the CIA agent with a backpack full of money going to the next warlord to buy him off. That's how we were able to obtain the support of a lot of the Northern Alliance. Yes, they were happy we were there to help fight off the Taliban, but in that culture, money and power talk. That's what builds alliances. One of the things that we had a problem with, though, is we were over-reliant on the warlords at the beginning of the war. Throughout the beginning of the war, when we finally put troops on the ground in the middle of October of 2001, we had only 1,300 soldiers and Afghanistan, 1,300, armed with the warlords. This is where we fought the infamous battles of Tora Bora with 3,000 soldiers in country, but we relied specifically on the warlords. And the warlords would go in, they would fight during the day, and at night they would back away and go back to their little camps and go to sleep, get up in the morning, wash up, go back to the fight. Well, they gave up all the ground they had taken. There was an over-reliance on the warlords to fight. And this is a problem that I would say we had throughout the entire war. We tried to fight the war on the cheap. We tried to rely a lot on the locals to fight this war. And as you see, small number of boots on the ground. We didn't hit the 20,000 soldier mark or personnel in Afghanistan until about 2004. Whereas in Iraq, we had over 100,000 personnel. But in a country, as you saw earlier, how large Afghanistan is, about four times the size of Florida, we had about 20,000 personnel. Yes, there was other OGAs, other government agencies, you know, CIA, everything else, DIA in country. But when you're trying to fight an enemy as elusive as that, you need to have boots on the ground covering areas. You know, reconnaissance elements are great, you can spot them, but you have to be able to get there quickly enough to action what you see. And we established the Afghan National Security Forces during this time. Okay, we got to create an army. And I'll get into some of the problems with that in a bit. Then towards the end of about 2004 and 5, while Kabul started becoming the central power for Afghanistan, you know, especially after the Bonn Conference of 2001, where Hamid Karzai was put in as the leader, we started removing the warlords. Well, the warlords were the ones that were controlling their districts, controlling their provinces. They were the good allies, really, to have. You know, and this, is a cultural thing. We tried to impose, really, Jeffersonian democracy, Western democracy in the country, and really wasn't ready for that. You know, they weren't settled. You know, they still had the insurgency going on, and the warlords were great at crushing the insurgency, but we didn't let them really crush the insurgency. And this is when we started the beginning of nation building, and I'll show you some pictures of the nation building. For the bulk of the war, it was nation building, and it was whack-a-mole, as I've heard it referred to recently. Taliban pop up one area, we flood that area, crush them. They pop up in another area, we go in and we crush them in another province or district. Again, defeat and deny the ACM, anti-coalition militias, their ability to operate in Afghanistan. The push to legitimize Kabul. I was part of an operation that took out one of the main warlords in Western Afghanistan, Ismail Khan, back in 2004. This was the part of the plan where we were taking warlords out and we're installing Kabul's men in their districts or provinces who really didn't have the affection or love of the people in those provinces. Boots on the ground increased. Back in 2009, when President Obama said, "We're pulling out in 2014, thus surrendering, if you will, the war in Afghanistan." You know, a private will tell you, a private in the military will tell you, an insurgency, it's based on what's going on the ground, not a timetable. You never put a time limit on counterinsurgency. It's got to be factors-based, what's going on, or conditions-based. Well, when we announced in 2009, we were pulling out in 2014, but we were going to flood 100,000 soldiers into Afghanistan to give the ANA that breathing room to function, we really set up ourselves for failure. Around 2005, the NATO contingent, ISAF, finally left Kabul and started filtering out into the countryside, as you saw up on the map. That didn't happen until about, again, 4 years after we got into Afghanistan. The other major focus was developing and supporting the Afghans at all levels, from the ministerial level, down to the company level, down to the checkpoint level, where we had American soldiers, mostly National Guardsmen and Army and reservists, were advising the Afghans on how to be a military, how to operate. And of course, negotiations began. Some of it was behind the scenes, and others was in the open. Hamid Karzai, a Pashtun, who was the first president, if you will, of Afghanistan, he wanted to negotiate with the Taliban as early as 2001. But Washington told him, no, we were going to crush them. It was our hubris that we could win unconditionally without understanding really the culture. At the end of 2014, as I said, enduring freedom ended and we transitioned into the support of the Afghan military. Again, train and support them. Counterterrorist operations continued, hunting down Al-Qaeda and other organizations, ISIS. And that's when the formal negotiations really took off, especially in 2020 and 2019, which led to the famous Doha Accords, which got us to where we are now. One of the things people ask, you know, what did I think about the Doha Accords? Okay, that was the agreement between the United States and the Taliban. We didn't let the Afghan government take part in the negotiations. Not a good idea, okay? One has to remember, in that culture, lying to advance Islam is acceptable. It's actually even encouraged. People don't realize this. So when we go to the Taliban, sign this piece of paper, you know, and you agree to this. Oh yeah, I agree to whatever you want, okay? They'll sign any piece of paper to you. They will tell you anything you want to hear, as long as they leave with on the advantage. And we as Westerners, or Americans in particular, really can't grasp that idea, which is a shame. We saw that, you know, with the Afghans we advised. They would lie to our face, and we knew they were lying, but we couldn't do anything about it. And that led to what happened in 2021, where the current administration said, well, they signed this Doha Accord and we got to follow it. Well, actually, the Doha Accord also specified, and it said to the Taliban, yes, we're going to release 5,000 of your prisoners. Yes, you know, we're going to pull out. However, if you do not enter the government legally, if you continue your war against Kabul, the Kabul government, we are going to bomb you until there's nothing left to bomb. That was the one thing that really kept the Taliban in check. But once we didn't do that, the Taliban, for the first time, were able to mass their forces and conduct their attacks. And then this year, when we pulled out not just the advisors, but the contractors that took care of the Afghan Air Force, the Afghan military's vehicles and equipment, Western contractors who took care of their aircraft, those aircraft, nobody was able to maintain. Their Air Force fell apart. And they had a lot of good aircraft, and I'll show you that in a slide. So the removal of those contractors, removal of those personnel, is really what led to where we got to with the fall of Kabul, as well as nobody holding the Kabul government accountable, not letting them do strategic planning or operational planning, not letting the Afghans really never got that, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. And of course, that led to the collapse and where we are now, the finger pointing. You know, just last night on Fox News, H.R. McMaster's was interviewed. He just came out with a new book, like all generals, and talking about, you know, why Afghanistan fell apart. Since in the last month, I've read over 12 different articles written by 12 different generals and analysts on why Afghanistan fell the way it did. It is what it is. A lot of it is, you know, hindsight. Some of it is denial. And again, the truth will eventually come out. But what I have seen with the official history of the U.S. in the early part of Enduring Freedom, I've seen in the official history a lot of glossing over. Battles that I had fought in or incidents that I had witnessed were basically either incorrectly recorded or they asked the wrong people. Now I talked about nation building. Just to give you an idea of what Afghanistan looked like in 2001 or so, this is from Kabul, circa 2005, my first tour in Afghanistan. Basically, I describe Afghanistan, especially Kabul, as looking like Berlin, circa 1946-47. year or so after the Second World War. That was Kabul. Every building shot up, destroyed, some remnants of war. That's famous TV Tower Hill. That was a landmark in Kabul. Pretty impressive, huh? The damage. Well, this is what Kabul looked like in 2020. Now, some people can say, okay, well, that's the physical aspect. Well, the nation building also was, and I could throw out the statistic, in 2001, there was only about 900,000 students in Afghanistan, 100% male. As of 2020, there was over 9 million students going to school, 60% male, 40% female. Women were going to school. Women were prosecutors, were in the government as ministers. Women were airline pilots in Afghanistan as of 2020. Not anymore. They've all been kicked out of government. They've all lost all their jobs and are back to wearing the burqas and back at home. Now the pictures of Kabul, 2020. If I didn't tell you that was Kabul, you would think that was teenagers somewhere in the world going to a rock concert. Actually, they are. They're at a music concert with teenage girls sitting over there. In the cities, they were definitely embracing Western culture, Western ideology, because they had access to it. In the hinterlands, society hadn't changed really since the 700s. Other than the vehicle, the collision cough, and maybe a cell phone and a generator, life had not changed much since 700 AD. This is a soccer stadium in Kabul. This is the famous soccer stadium. Soccer was brought back, sports were brought back, daily activities were brought back. This is the famous soccer stadium, Olympic soccer stadium, where the Taliban used it for sport, all right, executions. Famous videos of women being driven up to the goalposts, shot, because they were outside with a, you know, by themselves or not with a married man. This is all things that are starting to come back, unfortunately. And again, 20 years ago today, we, not knowing the Afghan culture, demanded that the Taliban hand over Osama bin Laden. Well, the Taliban is predominantly Pashtun. And part of, they have 13 principles in the Pashtun culture. The top three really are blood vengeance, hospitality, and taking care of the downtrodden, taking care of people that are in need of protection. Okay, Netanyahu. Well, Osama bin Laden, he was seeking sanctuary. So rather than going against their cultural background of turning Osama bin Laden over to the West, they said, well, we'll send experts over to see really, you know, what happened, if we should turn him over. They had no intention to. We, not understanding that, went to war in Afghanistan. It began on the 7th of October with aerial bombardments. Different command and control centers, airfields, air defense systems. But another thing that we dropped on Afghanistan wasn't just bombs. Medical rations, or food rations. In the first 2 weeks of the war in Afghanistan, we dropped over 900,000 meals to the Afghan people. Knowing that winter was coming, we didn't want them to starve. It wasn't until a few weeks later, after the bombing had taken place, special forces and Army Rangers began to infiltrate into the country. You know, the movie 12 Strong, so forth, so on. Army Rangers launched raids and seizing airfields in southern Afghanistan, seizing airfields, something that they're good at. The food rations we dropped on the Afghans. Each one of these meals dropped from C-17s, cargo planes, was one day's ration for an Afghan. And the war for 20 years took place in various conditions, whether it was deserts in the south or mountains in the north and in the east. Terrain like American soldiers have never fought in, at altitudes most people could not believe, 8,000, 10,000 feet elevations. With a system where there was no real roads. And yes, it does snow in Afghanistan, quite a bit. These are pictures from my second tour. One of my team leaders was on this mission. Towards the, about 2009 or so on, all U.S. or coalition forces, anytime they went on a mission, had to have Afghan forces with them, partnered with them. There's an American soldiers from the 2nd Infantry Division with Afghan soldiers. And a firefight here. This was taken in Kandahar province. And the advise, assist, and train mission was taking place, whether it was with reserve units or National Guard units or active components, trying to work with the Afghan forces to get them to a certain level of operations. A little bit of more of the terrain, and yes, we did fight in the cities. In that smoke over there, I didn't take this photo. I was in the middle of the fighting in that picture. This is after I had been ambushed on this road. Taliban set up their positions on that mountain, and as we came up this road, they shot our vehicle up. We had no choice but to continue on. That's Bagram back in the day. As you know, Afghanistan's been at war for quite a bit. Finding ammunition in Afghanistan is like trying to find a seashell on a beach in Florida. These are old Soviet ammo bunkers that we had secured during my first tour in 2004. There was 8 of them stacked to the ceiling with munitions. Many of these bunkers were opened. The United Nations went around trying to locate all these ammunition bunkers, opening them up, saying, okay, that's ammunition. And then they'd hire a local, give him an AK-47, say, protect this from, make sure no one gets in there. Okay, yeah, I'll guard it. And next thing you know, they're letting their buddies come in and ransack it before the United Nations had the ability to destroy what was in there. Warlords had plenty of munitions, all right, in vehicles. This is from one of the warlords. We confiscated over 100 armored vehicles from one warlord in Western Afghanistan. And then the landmines, as I talked about. This is what really brought a lot of our casualties, as well as the ANSAF casualties. That and IEDs. Some of the new, some of the old. You see over here is a 40-pound charge from an IED. I took that picture in southern Afghanistan on the Ring Road. Sometimes we'd find 200 pounds of IEDs or more. And to let you know, this is what a 40-pound charge looks like when it goes off. Okay, 40 pounds, that had the ability to destroy the front of a Humvee, of an armored Humvee. 40 pounds for personnel on it, there would be nothing left. The Afghans would put hundreds of pounds of this stuff underneath roads and culverts. Every time we came across a culvert in Afghanistan that was not guarded, we had to get out and visually inspect that culvert, which would slow up operations. And of course, the children of Afghanistan, as I talked about the schooling, whatnot. For a generation, the Afghan children, at least with the U.S. and coalition partners, was able to bring some semblance of a life to them, a future. That, unfortunately, my friends, is all gone. And then we talk about the Taliban as, well, they're Afghans, they're passionate, whatnot. The Afghans, as a people, love music. They love to sing, to dance, to tell jokes, to tell stories. They love to fly kites, as simple thing as flying a kite. Under the Taliban, that is illegal, punishable by death, imprisonment, or torture. If you're a man, you don't grow a beard, you'll be beaten and thrown in jail until you do. If you sing, you dance, you'll be executed. Tell jokes, you'll be beaten. To quote one of my interpreters from my first tour, Afghanistan was an insane asylum under the Taliban. And I am afraid now with $83 billion worth of material, it's going back to becoming an insane asylum. Those we depended on. When I first got there, this is what the Afghan army looked like. Locally made uniforms, single stitched uniforms that would tear very easily. Boots that were made in Pakistan. Most of these officers of theirs were trained by the Soviets, and that's what they fell back on, or were corrupt. They had bought their positions in the Afghan military. We tried to bring training to them, but a lot of times they would revert, once the training was done, to what worked best for them, the old Soviet doctrine of managing their personnel. When we started the Afghan military, it was a joint effort between the U.S., Britain, and France. Well, the U.S. ran basic training for the Afghan soldiers. Their non-commissioned officers were trained by the British. That left the French to train the officers. The Americans and British have a similar view on what the role of a non-commissioned officer is. The French didn't. And the way they trained their officers was different than the way our officers are. And we would be the ones, as Americans, would lead or be with, as advisors, the Afghan army in the field. And there was a lot of issues with that. But by 2020, the Afghan military had designed their own uniforms. Pretty good, actually. They were well-equipped. They had gotten rid of the old AK ammunition or AK-47s that they had. And now we're trying to become a modern military. But again, Americans say, you know, why didn't they get this? Why didn't they get this? Well, you got to remember, they've been at war for so long, they don't know really what it's like to have a modern military. They had an Afghan Air Force equipped with old Soviet equipment, as well as newer Western equipment. And again, it gets back to when we pulled the contractors out who worked on the aircraft, many of their forces or mechanics couldn't take care of that vehicles. And plus, it gets back to one of the big problems they had was they didn't know how to do strategic or long-term logistics planning. They did not know how to order material and track it or do the foreseeing and the predictions of how much equipment they're going to need for operations. And then there was these poor folks, the Ministry of the Interior, the police. Yes, there was female police. Afghan police, that was their normal duty uniform. But then there was these poor folks, the border guards, the border police. These guys would be sent out to border locations, and you'd see pictures of them with a chair, a radio, a cell phone, and a Kalashnikov sitting on top of a mountain by himself, and he's supposed to protect the borders of Afghanistan. In the end, who won? Oh, Taliban for now. Okay, you're back in control. Now what? What do? You've kicked a lot of the people that know how to run the government out of government. Now, they said they want to keep their engineers there and so forth. They know they're not going to last. So many with money have gotten out. China, Iran, Pakistan, and Russia. If you remember back on the map, Afghanistan was probably the most strategic location we ever had around the world. It was the gem in the crown, okay, as India used to be for Great Britain. With our forces, especially at Bagram, Shindan, Mazar-e Sharif, and Kandahar, we had access within an hour's flight of Iran, China, Russia, and Pakistan. We could monitor everything. We had now personnel on their flanks, and we've given that up. And as of last week, reports are starting to come out that the lights are back on at Bagram Air Force Base. Military aircraft are arriving at night with red stars on them, with little writing on it. The People's Republic of China has started to move in already into Bagram. I put this up here. The National Guard and Reserve components were one of the winners. Not since the Second World War has the National Guard and Reserve components of the U.S. military been so actively involved. It forced the government, forced the Department of Defense to modernize the reserve components, to bring them up to an active duty standard for the first time. And for the most part, they held up really well in combat. So kudos again to the citizen soldiers who stepped up during the war. Special forces, highly used for 20 years, no one questioned their budget or what they did. They doubled in size. At the beginning of the war, there was about 33,000 operators in U.S. Special Forces. Now there's over 70, close to 80,000 operators. So an increase in their force structure, modernization in equipment, as well as the U.S. military. You have an entire generation of soldiers, sailors, Marines, and airmen that have combat experience. If you were a private on 9/11, you're just retiring now as either a sergeant major or as a colonel. You've probably had either 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years of combat experience. You have an entire generation that has that experience. But however, a lot of it at the higher levels was counterinsurgency. But as many of us know, when a round flies past your head, it isn't counterinsurgency anymore. The U.S. military was able to modernize like it has never been able to since the 1980s. But of course, where there's winners, there's losers. The people of Afghanistan. Now, some people say, why didn't they fight? Well, if you know what's going to happen, when you know you're getting the death threats on a daily basis at night and there's nobody there to protect you, you're going to put down your weapon. When your family's threatened, you're in the military and your family gets death threats at night, what are you going to do? Are you going to stay in a province on the other side of Afghanistan with people you don't know, or are you going to go home and protect your family as best you can? And that's what I'm afraid a lot of the Afghans did in the military, especially when they weren't paid, they weren't equipped, they weren't taken care of, period. And as I said, there are especially the women, as I mentioned earlier, how far they had come ahead. Afghan security forces, the money we spent developing and modernizing them, I think we asked a lot of the Afghans. You know, people say, well, we were there for 20 years. Why couldn't they take the fight to them? I like to remind people, I'm a military historian. I was certified by the Army as a historian. Between, after the U.S. won the Battle of Yorktown in 1781, the U.S. never won an offensive operation on its own, except for Native Americans. We never won an offensive operation in any of our wars until the Mexican-American War of 1846. That's even after having West Point established in 1802. So for us to miraculously have a first-rate military after 20 years, where their whole basis was tribal warlord fighting, gangland fighting, and now we want them to become a military that is doing strategic planning, long-term military decision-making, you know, having staff schools. We asked a lot of the Afghans. NATO lost. It was our first defeat. It really tested the alliance for what it is. The United States. One of the things I like to remind people is, of all of our counterinsurgency operations, okay, the U.S. has only been successful once. I'm not talking about the Native Americans. I'm talking about the Philippine-American War, 1899 to 1902. And any war that lasted over 4 years, the U.S. has only won one. That was the American Revolution. We didn't win in Vietnam, and you can see what happened in Afghanistan. Special Forces also was a loser. They took basically a thoroughbred horse out of the barn, and they made it into a plow mule. They used it, and they used it, and they used it until it broke, okay? And this is something the Special Forces will continually have to analyze and see what they did. And I saw some of the teams that I was assigned or attached to became very lackadaisical about their skills. They weren't doing weapons maintenance, cleaning, and it was sad to see a lot of the teams not as good as they should have been. And the military. 22 suicides a day are in the U.S. military. 22 suicides a day. Military, high divorce rates, high deployment rates. As I said, you got guys with 8 deployments, combat deployments. That's 1 year away from their family. Okay? They come back, they take some vacation, now they gotta go get ready to deploy again. So yes, they're great at fighting, but now, what's at home for them? And with the fall of Kabul, now they're gonna look back, they might have been injured, they've lost friends, they're divorced, they're alcoholic, they're going to behavioral health, they've had several deployments to Afghanistan, and for what? This is the question that no single letter sent by the Chief of Staff of the Army on Facebook, "Don't worry, man, you did your job," is going to take care of. It's going to be a long, hard, just like in the 1970s after the fall of Saigon, it's going to be a long, hard, introspective look into where we came from. In the end, 1,845 Americans were killed in action in Afghanistan. Total number with coalition forces, close to 3,000. 66,000 Afghan personnel, soldiers, policemen were killed. God knows how many Al-Qaeda, Taliban, or ACM were killed. 504 non-hostile killed in action, of which I know one personally. Over 20,000 wounded in action as of this last month. And a budget of anywhere from $837 billion to $2 trillion. I don't think anybody will ever know because of all the black programs that took part in Afghanistan. And quickly, the observations, and these are, again, my opinions. Some of the things that led to where we got to. Cultural differences, okay? Not understanding of the culture, expecting them to become a Western country overnight. To quote Osama bin Laden, "You got the watches, I got the time." Expecting the Afghans, or the Taliban, to give up Osama bin Laden at the beginning of the war led to us getting to where we're at. Not knowing the terrain, as I explained earlier on, what it was like over there. Okay, very austere conditions. You might have a single infantry platoon or company operating miles and miles and miles from another American unit. If they got attacked, it took hours, if not days, to get reinforcements to them. Lack of patience. A lot of this was with the advisors. Now, why aren't they getting this? Rotations. Every year, a rotation of U.S. personnel came in. And with the advisors, a lot of it was, okay, I can't be in country when my replacement comes. So there was no handoff a lot of times with rotations. There might be some advance parties or whatnot, but on my final tour in Afghanistan, I couldn't be in country when my replacement came. I had to literally get on the phone with him at 11:30 at night to call Hawaii to talk to him and kind of bring him up to speed. Wanting to let them, the Afghans, succeed so much, we let them fail. As advisors, we'd write reports on the Afghan military. And by the time it got to the higher up, it had been sanitized. And I will say that out loud. We would write about the corruption. We'd write about all their problems, not getting what we're teaching them, the problems that they're having. And it was basically like, well, did they fall in for formation today? Yes. Okay, well, they got great accountability, perfect defense, all this stuff. We wanted them to succeed so much, we put so much effort into it, we weren't willing to look at reality in the face. And of course, the corruption. Everyone talks about the corruption, okay? If you had it so bad for so long, and now you have a golden opportunity to have money handed to you, and you can be as corrupt as you want, and no one's going to take you out of power, okay? The Soviets used to basically take people out of power. If you were corrupt, you're going to get a bullet in the back of the head. We weren't that way. My first team, we used to call the Afghans that we advised, that we were advising the Sopranos. We actually came in on them when they opened up the books and they were going down their spoils and how much they looted out of a village that they had done an operation in. It got to the point where the Afghan military was selling the fuel we were putting in their vehicles. So NATO had to put a dye, a blue dye, in all the fuel so that we could track all the corruption and where the fuel was being sold. And I think that led to a lot of the Afghan soldiers losing heart in what they were part of, because their leaders were corrupt, they weren't being taken care of. The average Afghan soldier, a private, was making about $70 a month. Well, to feed a family, just to feed a person, was about $5 a day. Well, I had a D- in college math, and you know, 5 times 30, you get the hint. That $70 is not going to cover it. And one of the problems we had was with the Afghan soldiers, they had to borrow money to take care of their family. So now payday comes, there's that officer or NCO standing outside the door, say, hey, you got my money? And that soldier now has to, once he pays that, whatever he's got left, he's got to go down to his home village that could be on the other side of the country, drop off the money, get back in a vehicle or some way, and get back to his camp. So we would lose entire Afghan units for 2 weeks out of the month while they went and dropped off the money at their village. Risk adverse and fob-centric. Fob-centric is a term I came up with where the U.S. military was hunkered down on our forward operating bases and our bases. We didn't really go out. We'd do our missions, and then it would come running back to our fobs. We really didn't get with the people as much as I thought we should have. They're in my first tour. We really got with the Afghan people. We're in their villages. But after that, everything was in the villages or in the bases. It got to the point where soldiers were going on deployments. Oh, we're going to Afghanistan? Well, I'm going to pack a cold weather gear or this, but I'm also going to pack my PlayStation, my TV, the refrigerator, because I knew they were going to a base. Another problem I saw was you had some of the leaders who were, well, when I was in Iraq, this worked. Well, as I explained to you earlier, what Iraq was kind of like, and the best way I describe it for World War II would be the European theater of operations, Iraq, versus the Pacific theater of operations, Afghanistan. Same war, but totally different ways of fighting and conducting operations. Afghanistan was very austere, very hard to operate, you know, between the snow, the deserts, the mountains, the limited infrastructure, versus Iraq, where he had second world nation, being able to conduct maneuver out in the desert and so forth. And the other thing, there was rules of engagement that came out around 2009, bought off by General Stanley McChrystal. And it was called the Karzai 12. Violation of any of these, and you had to get a colonel to sign off. If it was, then you had to get a general to sign off. Violation of two or more of any of these 12, you had to have the commander of ISAF to sign off on an operation. So if a company was going to go on an operation, they had a, and they violated two or more of these, they had to get a four-star general to approve their operation. It sounds insane, but that's how Afghanistan was. No night searches or surprise searches. We couldn't search a village, an Afghan village, at night. We had to give them warning if we were coming in to search them. We had to wait for Afghan security forces to accompany us. There were many times we went on missions, we were sitting on the side of the road waiting for the Afghan army to accompany us, for them to never show up, waiting now for whoever we're calling back to contact someone higher up to get approval, because now we're violating one of those Karzai 12s. Yes. Don't fire unless they're ready to pull the trigger. Because if somebody walking with an AK-47 or 50 of them walking with an AK-47 and vests doesn't mean anything. They might be hunting. Don't engage civilian. Don't engage the Afghans if civilians are present. Well, if they're pointing out, the civilians are pointing out where the Americans are, is that still a civilian? Not according to the law of war, but I digress. But the thing is, you know, Americans were forced to, you know, they say in Vietnam, fight with one hand tied behind their back. A lot of times in Afghanistan, they were fighting with their legs, hands tied behind their back, and a blindfold on. My first tour saw an ODA, a special forces team, and some of my guys got ambushed by an old Soviet armored vehicle. They got ambushed in a village, shot up our vehicles. Our guys were able to get out. They called in an A-10 to attack the vehicle. Denied. Why are they being denied? Why? Because it was in a village. Only women can search women. Pretty obvious. Yep. So if so if he's putting the IED in, you can shoot him. But if he's walking away after putting it in, you can't. This happened at FOB Ramrod, which was a major installation in western Kandahar province along the Ring Road. It was kind of set back from the Ring Road. And literally on the video, because the cameras, you could watch the Taliban drive up on a motorcycle, two guys, one guy drops off the back, digs up a hole right in front of the main gate for the FOB, puts an IED in, covers it up, gets on the bike and takes off before they can do anything about it. After that, U.S. forces had to clear every day when they left the base. They had to clear from the front gate to the main road, a distance of about a quarter of a mile. They had to clear it because it was now all mined. That's not the 12, but that's just gives you an idea of the rules of engagement from 2009 on that U.S. personnel and NATO personnel had to deal with in Afghanistan. You know, if you want to get a better understanding of what it was like in Afghanistan, there's two movies, documentary-type movies, that I highly recommend. Obviously, it's Restrepo, and the other one's The Hornet's Nest, which gives you an idea of what it was like in southern Afghanistan with the Marines, as well as in eastern Afghanistan. If you had to choose between the two, I'd go with The Hornet's Nest. And books. The one over here was written in 1995 by Dr. Leslie Grew, who I met. He interviewed in 94, 95, various Mujahideen leaders from the war with the Soviets. And they analyzed all their big battles and what they did and how they did it. And Leslie Grew breaks it up based on the ambushes and stuff like that. Anybody who ever serves in Afghanistan and didn't, if you're a leader and didn't read this book, you weren't serious about Afghanistan, because the Taliban, for the most part, would use the same tactics, same locations, same everything as was in the book. Another one is from the advisor's perspective. Greens from Afghanistan, send more ammo. Quick read, you could read it probably in a day. Funny, but you see what the problems that the advisors were having. And just three other books. You know, Why We Lost, by General retired Daniel Bolger, who I worked with, I knew. And he's probably the first general I ever saw write in writing, you know, who lost the war again, the global war on terrorism? I did. And he explains why the senior leaders lost the war. Little America, a little bit about the history of U.S. involvement in Afghanistan, especially in the South. And the book, The Outpost, which was made into a movie recently, about the battle at Kop Keating. I'm very attached to the book because Kop Keating was named after Captain Benjamin Keating, who was a cadet that I taught in ROTC. That was the first time I met his family. It was when I commissioned him. Second time was Plainside, when I put the flag on his casket when he was returned home. So it's an excellent book, quite long, but it gives you an idea of what it's like to be out in the hinterlands of Afghanistan. With that said, I know I went way long, but Afghanistan, as I said, is a long war. 20 years, you cannot sum up 20 years in a matter of minutes. And today was the beginning of, even though, you know, the Mujahideen or the terrorists had declared war on the United States long before, but October 7th was when we finally got involved and put boots on the ground, something they never thought we'd ever do. And with that said, I'll take questions. Yes. Simple answer, yes. That's what led to the Taliban actually coming to power, was the corruption with the warlords was so bad after the fall of the communist government and the government with the Soviets. And when the warlords started coming into power, because now you had Mujahideen leaders with a lot of weapons, the different factions that controlled different areas, they made their own little fiefdoms. And it was really affecting what Afghans saw as, honestly, hey, I don't want to be shaken down. So that's why a lot of the population went to the Taliban side. And unfortunately, the corruption that the former regime had is also what drove, I think, a lot of the population to the Taliban side, unfortunately. They made a deal with the devil. It depends. It really depends. You know, if you live out in the villages, if you live in, and again, these are all my opinions, whatnot. If you live out in the villages that has not changed since, you know, the 17th, 18th century, you don't know technology. You don't know what the rest of civilization is like. And you're just content being a farmer. Yeah, because you're probably an extremist or whatnot. Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's good for you because you're not having the police roll into your village and shake you down. But if you live in the villages, or excuse me, in the cities like Kabul, Kandahar, Herat, Mazar-e Sharif, you're going to hell. I mean, yes, there was corruption in those cities, but really, isn't there corruption in a lot of other countries too? You know, but the way of life under the Taliban is so extreme, it doesn't... It really suppresses the natural urges that I saw of the Afghan people, you know, which is fun-loving people, very hospitable, I mean, very kind people. They would give you the last piece of bread in their house, the last shirt on their back, if you treated them with respect. And I love the Afghan people for that. And many of my friends, many of my interpreters, I was able to get out of the country. Yes.
With the strategic positioning of Afghanistan, wouldn't it have made sense for us to maintain a presence there?
Good. I'm glad you asked that question. That's a $1,000 question or a $1 million question. Yes. You know, people say, should we have kept a stay-behind force? Absolutely, 100%. You know, I will never change my opinion on that. If we had kept, I personally believe, forces at Bagram, Kandahar, and Shindan, which was south of Herat, which was where their air base, if we had kept soldiers at the air base, just enough to even maintain with the Afghans' equipment, help them maintain their equipment, and let them do the fighting, the Afghan Air Force do their fighting, Kabul wouldn't have fallen. Because once they lost that air power, the Afghan army lost that ability to conduct airstrikes, the Taliban was able to mass their forces.
I mean, I look at it as different than the Vietnam War in that we didn't, I mean, any lives that we lose there is tragic. Mm-hmm. But if you compare the two, it's like night and day. And I mean, we maintain troops all over the world.
I was talking to someone recently and they said, well, you know, we got troops in Korea, in South Korea. We've had them there for 80, you know, 70 plus years now, okay? Does anybody in this room think the South Koreans need defending? If North Korea ever did anything to South Korea, the South Koreans would roll up the North Korean army in an afternoon and still have time to have a good dinner, okay? The ROK army is not the ROK army of June of 1950. They're professional, very well disciplined. and hard fighters. Us giving up Afghanistan, pulling out, was probably one of the biggest strategic blunders that I've seen in probably over 100 years. Because we, as I said, it was the gem in the crown. You had China, you had Russia to the north, you had Pakistan right there, and then you had Iran. With Iran, we have troops in Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, okay, and a naval fleet in the Persian Gulf. We had Iran boxed in. Not anymore. Well, what do I know? I was just a lieutenant colonel. Yes?
Not really a question, but opinion and commentary. Opinion from you. In World War II,
that's fine.
In World War II,
well, it's not really a question.
Okay, yeah.
In World War II, if a unit was going to be attacking a structure, the first thing they would do is they'd use a flamethrower if they had one. Following that, up until the present day, how much of our problems is our own cultural issues and their impact not only on the way that we conduct war currently, actually since Vietnam more than anything, and our inability forever from being able to have an interest in other people's cultures, their upbringing, their traditions, how it impacts their correspondence to us, our evaluation of those correspondence, the selection of interpreters. I mean, all of it is all woven together.
You bring up a couple points where you're talking about the flamethrowers and everything like that. Some people call it the CNN effect, okay, of modern warfare. The CNN effect is we bomb a target. What do they focus in on? Oh, you know, they bring out what looks like civilians, okay? Well, I hate to tell you folks, the Taliban doesn't wear uniforms. Now they may, since we left them, but they don't wear uniforms. So a lot of times we would have instances where we would have engagements, and next thing you know, oh, you killed five civilians. Okay, we killed five military-age males, you know, who, a few moments before were shooting, but after we shot them, their friends went and cleaned out their weapons. But as far as the cultural thing is, I think it's, again, goes back to we're America, we know what's best, and we really don't analyze the culture as well as we should. And I think if we had known more about Afghanistan, that isolated country, knew about the different tribes, because a lot of times we would go attack, we'd get information, oh, this village is where the Taliban are, and we'd go into a village. Well, actually, what we're doing is we're ending a blood feud between two tribes, you know, because one village lost a sheep 200 years ago, now they're going to end that little squabble, and you think I'm joking, this is some of the stuff that happened. You know, we would go and attack a village thinking there were Taliban there. Oh, it's because the other village had a beef with them. So.
Kind of small follow-up, if I may. Something as simple as what training does an advisor receive in the use of an interpreter? And
okay.
How that interpreter's perceptions based on his cultural background,
yeah.
Your phrasing, the words you're using.
Excellent. You know, when I first went to Afghanistan, we had very little training on the use of our interpreters, or as we call them, Tajiman. You know, and a lot of these were young kids that went to school, got rudimentary English. They weren't, and there was different levels of interpreters. The higher your rank was in the military, the better your interpreter. By the time you got down to the unit level, we had guys that could do some English. But as far as speaking with the Afghans, what might be a simple question of how many vehicles do you have for your mission tomorrow, that might take 15 minutes to get the right answer from them, because the interpreters are listening to you, trying to figure out how he's going to say it, and then he'd spit out to the Afghan officer. And the Afghan officer spits it back, and then he's got to translate it. Well, things get lost in translation. Plus, also, there might be a cultural difference, Pashtun and Tajik. There might be some issues like, hey, if you tell him the truth, I'm going to find out and I'm going to kill you type stuff. And then you had interpreters that were in it for the money. We had some that, you know, they would go down and buy an item for $10 when in actuality it cost $5 and they made a $5 profit off the local shop owners. And they would run little deals on the side, talking about corruption. But as far as the interpreters, we would tend to only use or advise the Afghans for about 3 hours a day. Reason why is the interpreters sometimes would get interpreter fatigue. If you're trying to translate for 3+ hours between two different languages and not lose the meaning, you're a Superman. That's really hard to do. And you could see the interpreters would start getting fatigued. And then we went on missions out in the, you know, on patrols or whatnot. You know, sometimes we'd have to arm our interpreters. They weren't supposed to be armed, but we would give them their own AK-47s with one magazine. Why? Do you want to have this guy who's your most vital link, your biggest target in the, you know, in that whole chain? Your interpreter was as vital as your radio, because if he got wounded or killed, you can't communicate now with the Afghan soldiers. And now you've just been totally cut in half. Or when I was an advisor, we'd operate in two-man teams. Advisor teams were 16 men, but we'd go out on missions. Two men had to be as good as a 12-man Special Forces A team. We were our own medics, weapons experts, engineers, communication specialists, and we weren't trained for this, but we had to become that good on the fly. Okay? Yes. Any other questions? God, I know it wasn't that good.
I'll ask one more.
Oh, okay, one.
Would we have had a better chance of success had we taken the concept of Vietnam-era Special Forces base camps and transferred that into the Afghan scenario?
Well, we kind of had them. And in fact, I was at one called Fob Tilman, which was on the Pakistan border. It was 3 kilometers from the Pakistan border. And you go out to the foyer, you'll see a piece of a rocket that landed near where I was staying. Yes, you know, I've heard it said, you know, in Vietnam we were able to put more troops in the villages than in Afghanistan. If you remember earlier, one of the early slides, Afghanistan is 3¾ the size of South Vietnam. In South Vietnam, we had 500,000 troops. You know, in Afghanistan, we had about 140,000, including our NATO partners, and that's not all ground troops. So, you know, we relied a lot on technology, and a lot of it goes back to Donald Rumsfeld at the beginning of the war, where he wanted to fight the wars on the cheap, you know, relying on special forces, technology, local forces. Well, the local forces could be bought off both sides, and that's what happened at Tora Bora, where Al-Qaeda and the Taliban paid off the militias that were fighting for us to let them go. So it was a hell of a war. You know, a lot of analysis will be done, but eventually we'll get to the next war. With that said, I thank you all for coming, and I'm sorry it took so long, but thank you.
Thank you, Justin. You know, Justin's been with us for a few years now here at the Military Heritage Museum, and we're so fortunate to have him and his other great veterans that serve here. It's so awesome to be able to get that firsthand information, and Justin put a lot of work into preparing this lecture, and I thank you all for coming and being part of something so unique and so, you know, so special that, you know, you're not going to find this kind of information pretty much probably in most of the media the way that Justin's presented it. So I'm sure Justin will be here because he's one of our great museum guides. If you have more questions, feel free to talk to him on a one-on-one basis. Again, Justin, thank you so much. We can't thank you enough for doing this lecture.